Hi everyone, I hope you're doing well. My name is Jack Letros and today I'll be presenting a design proposal for the K. Blair Hospice. I hope this video provides a clear and effective representation of the design intention. Looking into the site planning, the site has a rare and open opportunity to take advantage of the existing natural qualities, mainly highlighting the natural heritage area. Dense with mature trees, this area provides an exposure to the region's natural qualities as well as a physical, visual, and auditorial buffer from other areas. Along with these qualities, we can begin to look at how the hospice can respond in relation to the site. In general, the hospice can be split into two fragments, semi-private and private, while the street and sidewalks would be considered public. Here, we can see how the semi-private spaces can be used as a buffer to separate private from public. This buffer can benefit in consideration of noise and visual barriers to promote privacy for residents and visitors. From here, we can begin to look at how these concepts can influence the ideal way space within the hospice is experienced. Diving a bit deeper, concepts of security, comfortability, and familiarity can all be used to promote what could be described as positive vulnerability. These ideas come together in hopes of creating and influencing a time that the resident and visitors are comfortable to be open and experience their last moments together with a free and open mind, creating opportunities to share thoughts, experiences, and emotion with dignity, respect, and privacy. From here, we can start to take a look at the plans and program, more specifically how program is organized in relation to the site and other programmatic features. Looking at the ground floor and site plan, we again see the relationship of the semi-private to public spaces. Here, we can see how the administrative spaces are used as a buffer and how the more publicly used areas do the same. The resident spaces are comprised of two wings, featuring the nurse's station in the center and all the supporting program nearby. The placement of these resident units also promotes a strong connection to the natural heritage area, utilizing the healing capabilities of nature to enable comfortable living environments and ultimately the positive vulnerability previously mentioned. We can also notice that all of the program utilized by visitors and residents are on one floor to simplify the spaces and considering ease of accessibility to those not able to climb stairs. Doing so also reduces the exterior height and scale of the building, which will be highlighted later on. Following this, we can see the basement plan, where laundry rooms, mechanical and electrical spaces, and additional storage can be found. Now with the main ideas coming to fruition, they will be applied in a study of the system integration and code analysis process. With system integration, we begin to see the priorities between spaces and how the systems can be implemented. In terms of air and thermal control, it may be considered to have individual controls for the temperature using a thermostat to adjust to each resident's particular needs. Along with this, we may consider the implementation of HRV or ERV systems. A solution to this may be the Lunos E2 HRV. This system can be implemented in each room and adjust the specific needs of each unit of ventilation, bringing direct fresh air into the room. This system also does not require ducts, reducing the need for ductwork and maintenance. Plumbing and HVAC have been considered in their vertical alignment of utilities, providing ease of maintenance and repair work. This is also supported by shared walls between unit bathrooms and more. We also take a look at the structural implementation. As mentioned before, mass timber will be used as the primary structure of the hospice. This allows for the idea of CLT module systems for the resident suites and a CLT wall and floor system throughout the hospice. This can also be used in conjunction with glue on post and beams, and in some cases supported by traditional stick framing. It is also important to mention the use of rammed earth as a wall material. As you can see in the lower right image, the rammed earth is used as a continuous wall separating the resident spaces from the semi-private and public areas. More about rammed earth as a material will come later on. Next, we'll look at the code analysis and how the proposed building responds. In terms of zoning, the current zoning is agricultural, which would need to be adjusted to an institutional 2 zone, which will be considered for the following study. The building responds to a 7.5 meter setback from the property line. The parking responds to a 0.5 meter setback from the property line along the proposed street, and the building also responds to a 9.5 meter setback along the natural heritage area. The building also falls below the maximum 33% lot coverage with a total area of 1984 meters squared. There are 9 proposed parking stalls matching the 9 stall minimum, and is also below the maximum building height of 3 stories, sitting at 1 story tall. The building can be entered through both access options, but the main entrance is from the proposed street. In terms of cost, we can take a look at the breakdown at a high level, with the hard cost to soft cost ratio of 8 to 2 and a total budget of $14 million. We are left with $11.2 million as hard cost allocation, splitting up the gross floor area into three zones: indoor public space zone using an assisted care resident cost, the resident and medical zone using a low-level hospital cost, and the basement. The typical spot cost per square meter parameters were identified and applied to the respective fragments and used to calculate the building cost. With all in consideration, the building would cost about $10.9 million, leaving about $250,000 left for other hard cost items like site development and landscaping. This small amount does not seem sufficient and would need to be considered. In terms of efficiency, the current plan sees an efficiency of 56%, which comes below the desired margin. This inefficiency is largely due to the widened hallways along the resident area and the open public entry area. Taking a look at the facades in urbanism, we can now see how the building looks in three dimensions. Starting with the Bramley Road elevation, we can see that the building takes a low and wide approach, doing so to reduce the scale of the building to potential occupants, while also providing a clear urban edge. This low roofline also allows the connection to nature, while one can still see the tips of the trees from the natural heritage area. We can also see the separation of public use spaces on the left side to the administrative spaces on the right. This perspective is what would be seen from the corner of Bramley Road and the proposed street. Here we can see the use of materiality as well as the roof system. The roof ridge is raised to allow the use of a clerestory window system to bring the south light deep into the space. Next, we can see the elevation of the proposed street. This portion mainly serves as the main entrance with circulation for vehicles and parking. We can also see how a green roof is utilized over the top of the resident unit wing to provide natural insulation, acoustic deadening, and further the building's connection to nature. We can see here that the landscape area serves as a buffer from the street, creating a more private entrance, and the landscaping along the sidewalk serves to create a more defined urban edge. Looking closer, we can see the driveway, the use of permeable pavers within the parking stalls, and the walkways along the building's exterior leading to the entrance. Here, we again see the tips of the trees from the heritage area and the green roof, promoting the building's connection to nature. And lastly, we see the elevation of the resident rooms and semi-private spaces on the right side. Next, we'll look to the interior and how all of the discussed concepts come together. Upon entry, we are greeted with an open communal space, which opposed direct connections to the building's kitchen, gathering spaces, and more. We also see the introduction of a courtyard area, flanked by the dining spaces, and a small library with private reading and sitting nooks. Looking closer to the dining area, it features a direct connection to the exterior, welcoming abundant south light. Seen here, the large windows also serve as pivoting doors, which can be opened during warm weather, welcoming the use of a landscaped private exterior space. Next, we can see a perspective section where we can further see the connection between the courtyard, dining spaces, private sitting spaces, and nature. Here, we can see the use of the small library area, as well as the additional entry point that leads to the natural heritage area path system. And finally, we can see the private sitting nooks throughout the day, where one can read and enjoy a morning coffee looking directly into the natural heritage area. Moving on, we can see the hallway leading to the residence wing. Again, we can see the use of the mass timber structure in conjunction with the rand earth separation wall. This leads us to the resident wing entrance, which is directly connected to the nurses' station and another entrance from the natural heritage area pathway. This space allows for easy monitoring of residents as well as the entry and exit of visitors. In this section, we can see the connection between the circulatory spaces, green roof system, and the resident units. As we can see here, the resident units feature a clerestory window bringing natural southern light into the space. Upon entry into the bedroom, there is immediately a direct connection to nature, supported by large windows with direct views to the heritage area. And here we can see the rammed earth feature wall that separates the units. Looking into the exterior spaces of the units, we can see the functionality of a divider wall, which utilizes cedar 2x6s to act as louvers. These louvers can have varying angles depending on the unit location, so the maximum connection to the heritage area is provided while still maintaining privacy between units. We end our journey with the perspective that matters most, the resident. This space, while simple, offers a cozy environment with the use of familiar materials and warm tones. Throughout the day, natural light passes through and finishes in the direction of the natural heritage area. Directly next to the bed, there's seating for your loved ones. Here, you can enjoy each other's company, where eventually one can share their final thoughts, feelings, stories, and emotion with those who matter most. And that brings us to the conclusion of this presentation. Overall, this proposal aims to provide a comfortable, warm, and familiar environment to all of its visitors, and hopes of providing a pure and peaceful visit. Thanks so much for listening. 'Cause I'm a little unsteady.